You are listening to Off Planet Radio at offplanetradio.net and offplanetradio.com.
Hello and welcome to Off Planet TV. I'm Randy Moggins, and we are we're attempting today to do what is probably one of the most difficult interviews I've ever had to arrange. On the line with me is author Cara St. Louis, and yeah. In this interview with Cara, and later also with her co-author Harold Kautzvella, we're going to attempt to pull together some of the most salient points covered in their book, Dangerous Imagination, Silent Assimilation, published in late 2014. Yep. The scope of this data, information, the historical backdrop is so far beyond any single interview. But what we're going to try to do is integrate the most fundamental information from both Harold and Cara, as well as the more recent recordings that they've done on the internet. I want to underscore the urgency of seeding this information timely and encouraging our listeners and viewers to do their research. By getting the book and accessing the interviews that they've done on the internet, both Cara and Harold singularly and together, and understand something, this information is a complete paradigm that's been in process for over 100 years. It has its roots in the ancient mystery schools and social engineering that began long before the phrase itself was coined, and it extends back as well into more ancient times with an agenda of malevolence towards the human race by what we can only term at this point as alien entities under numerous names: demons, archons, alien outliers who influence and attempt to assimilate the human soul and consciousness. And with that, I want to welcome on the line Cara St. Louis. Welcome.
Randy, it's so good to finally be here talking to you face to face.
It's been an amazing, it's an amazing process, actually, yeah. Because what we've had to go through is in itself so much spiritual warfare.
Yeah, absolutely.
In terms of getting connections done and meeting schedules and trying to get technology to work, which most of the time seems to work. But for some reason, whenever we involve ourselves in this endeavor, things don't seem to work anymore.
Go figure, you know. And it's really interesting because with Harold, it always ends up being that some demon is chasing him. And you think I'm being metaphoric, but you know what? I'm not. No. There are black magicians after him constantly. And he's absolutely fearless. He just does what he needs to do, executes evasive maneuvers, and then he keeps talking. And he laughs the whole time. He calls them the apes, okay? The apes are after me again, he says, right? So I love him to death for that kind of attitude. I really do. And I consider myself to be exceedingly fortunate to have been able to hook up with him. And although I don't think it's an accident, I can tell you that story because it's really a good story. And then with me, when I'm in the United States or when I'm talking to somebody in the U.S., Skype. It's always Skype, man. It's so easy to pull the plug on Skype if you're doing an interview. And Harold has said that it's because, and I think he's probably right. I mean, one wonders, why me? Why me, of all people? Yeah. But it's because I'm midwifing this stuff to the everyday guy. You know, I'm just talking to every man in America, and I'm trying to make it very understandable and very not scary, and to say, look, I encountered this stuff, and I took it in and I let it change me, and I'm going forward, and I'm trying to save my own children, and I'm trying to save your children, and I'm just trying to learn. And if I can do it, anybody can do it. And that makes me really scary, apparently, to the people who can pull the plug on Skype. So Randy and I have made this agreement that every time they pull the plug today, we're going to call each other back, and we're just going to keep talking, and that's all we can do, right?
We're going to keep going, Cara.
Yeah.
Give us a little bit of your background. I know I've read your bios, and I've seen your history and your background, some of which you've outlined in a previous book that you did, which details, I guess, beginning with the death of your mother and her activities and how that kind of dovetails into your own journey down what I guess by now is that really, really myriad of trails that go into the rabbit hole.
It's astonishing. It's really astonishing. Yeah. And not only is it astonishing, but it's right there for all of us to see. It's the biggest open secret you've ever seen in your life. All you have to do is be willing to have a look. It's right there. Yeah. They can't lie to us because they have to park the truth somewhere or the lie doesn't work. I've always believed that that's the case. Why is it we can see all of these things? Why are they so obvious? Because that's magic. That's balance. That's all of that stuff. You cannot lie to people unless you park the truth somewhere. So the truth is right there. And Simon Parks, who you may or may not have ever heard of.
Parks, I talked to him,
You talked to Parks? Yeah. I was recently supposed, as a matter of fact, let me take a segue really quick because this is interesting. I was supposed to be on a panel with him, he and myself, for Miles Johnston. Last month or the month before,
Bases,
something like
Miles
that.
Bases. Bases, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. He ended up getting Harold. Ah! So that was great. And I mean, it was brilliant. I was like, okay, so I can get you Harold. You're going to like it if I do. Yeah. And so we got Harold, and he's got like, I don't know, 40,000 views of his interview immediately or something because he's amazing. But anyway, I was supposed to be on with Simon Parks.
But you're amazing too, by the way.
Oh, well, thank you. Anyway, I was supposed to be on with Simon. And I had it. I have his Skype. I try to get a hold of him. I can never get a hold of him. I have my theories about why
that is. He only
works
by appointment. I talked to him for 15 minutes about a month ago.
Yeah, yeah.
We're planning an interview, but that's probably not forthcoming. He's just too busy.
Well, and it's not just that. He says that there's somebody new in town. There's a new actor in the arena somewhere. He says this. Now, I have my own theories about all this stuff, but he says there's a new actor in town that is not a Manted or anybody else that we are aware of, and that things are changing and that it's going on. It's affecting mostly Canada. I don't know why Canada, but it's most of the action's going on in Canada right now. And he didn't want to talk about it. So that's why he wasn't coming on with me. I actually don't think that's the case. I think that he and I are working on it. Honestly, one of these days, and I will call you up for this interview because I'm working on something big right now that has to do with me. And that has to do with my life, shall I say my life, that's led to this moment.
I think I know where you're going with this.
You know
this.
Where I'm going.
Yeah, I do, because as you well know, this is kind of what I do. So intuitively, I'm sensing it right now. I know. I know exactly what you're
doing. Good, I'm glad, because I
that's my background too, by the way.
Is it?
So.
Oh, cool. Because I have, good, because I need to talk to you then. I have a connection, I guess you could say, a deep connection. I'm completely, utterly connected to an intradimensional race that is here now, that is becoming more open, because we are here to defend Sophia from the attack.
We are.
Just to defend Sophia. Well, it is, and I've talked to Maria Wheatley about this as well, and to Harold, and to a couple of other people, not a lot of people, because this isn't the kind of thing that you just blabber about. But the reality is, it's a kind of a diametrically opposed entity to what you might call the Manted.
Okay.
Do you see what I'm saying? It's like you kind of, there's two unbelievably different agendas going on there. There's also someone, can't remember who told me this, it might have been Miles, but there's someone who works with the djinn. It's a woman, and I can't remember her name, but Miles had interviewed her. I don't worry too much about the djinn, even though they are intradimensional. Mm-hmm. We're on completely different sort of paths. They really cannot interfere with my consciousness, or yours probably, if you're thinking the same thing I'm thinking.
Yeah.
We're sort of impenetrable by lots and lots of things.
Shield.
Yeah, we do have a shield, doggone it.
Yeah.
That's because we are ancient, are we not? Mm-hmm. We are ancient bloodline.
Yeah.
And we are here, Maria Wheatley, who is she's a dowser. She's a master dowser, one of the guardians of Avebury. Her father was Dennis Wheatley, who apparently is a really famous writer. And I have to say,
Dennis Wheatley is a very famous, I didn't make that connection before. That's interesting.
Well, He was also a master dowser. Did you realize that?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was very deeply connected to Abe Berry, and she became a really, really good friend, a dear friend of mine, when I went to interview her when I was working for the People's Voice.
Okay, and, all right, that's a part of your history.
I was there. Yeah. What a ride that was, man. I was in that office till we were down to like the last six people.
I was in Boulder, Colorado when that network was announced back in 2013 by David himself.
Icke.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, we were holding a conference in Boulder that weekend.
When we were down, Boulder, were you there? Okay, so you must know some of the same people I know.
We have a lot of cross-pollination, I guarantee you,
some of the people who were there in Boulder to try to help set it up. Because Boulder sounds familiar to me, like somebody else has talked about that.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I did work for Icke, and when we were down to the last six people in the office, I was telling him, David, we're still infiltrated. And I know who it was, too. I'm not going to say it right now because I don't want to get sued. But
We don't.
But he was saying, yeah, of course we're still infiltrated. Jesus, it's Wimbledon. Wimbledon is a pit and blah, 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 you know. But we also, interestingly enough, I want to say this, too. I've never said this before either. But we had this homeless woman who was constantly sneaking into the office in Wimbledon. Mm-hmm. She was a hoot. She was a clairvoyant. With a sleeping bag under her arm kind of thing.
Oh, wow.
And she was always sneaking into the office. And we would sit there and listen to her for a long time because she seemed terrifically legit, you know, in her own way. And then one day she just popped up with this message. She's like, so you realize that's not David Icke, right? We went, what? What? So, I mean, she...
How interesting.
Yeah, right? So I don't know. What do you think? What do you think, Randy?
The connections are just myriad. I go someplace, and I don't do a lot of public stuff, but I go places, and people just begin to connect. It's like...
That's it.
Doing this radio show now, this is year number seven of doing this show. I've seen the amazing connections that come forth, just intuitively.
Yeah.
Most of what I think we do... Yeah. Is drawn off of the intuitive inner knowing of do this, don't do that, move here, move there. This interview is very intuitive as well.
It is. You're right in my solar plexus and my heart chakra right now. Yeah. You can feel that, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. It's really strong. We need to have a conversation, a private conversation, that we can then share if we feel like we need to share it about what we're supposed to be doing right now, because we really are supposed to be coming.
Well, I suspect you, like me, knew as a child.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And had a sense of mission.
Mm-hmm.
And that mission was always messed with. So you were messed with.
Always.
And your kids are messed with. And your life's messed with.
Yep.
And yet, in spite of it, all that turbulence, that's actually building us. That's the gymnasium in the spirit that's building our tenacity to be able to do this. Because this is the final push.
It is. This is the turn of the tide.
Yeah, we either do this.
Yep. And we're going to.
The singularity will take over.
Yeah.
And I think that we are the sand in the ointment, in the gears. We are the ones that are gumming up the works right now.
Right. Oh, you better believe it, baby. How I came, yes, and I've always known, just as you've always known, but they turn up the heat, man. They turn up the heat. And sometimes, you know, interestingly enough, what it is if you are fortunate enough to have this kind of an incarnation where there's this constant roll of the cosmic dice where it's like, look, everything's at stake right now. Either this is going to go really horribly wrong or you are going to fly, man. One of the two things is going to happen, but the gamble is freaking enormous every time, and it happens over and over and over again. And that's okay, because I'm used to that now. You're probably used to that as well, right?
Yeah.
You know, how I found out consciously, because these things come to us in bits, and I will tell you a little bit of my story, but recently, what's important is I was in Berlin doing an interview with Kaut Sevilla, all right, and then he went off to his farm, which is in near Berlin somewhere. I've never been there yet, but and I went to a hotel near the airport because I just kind of like to be close to the airplanes, and I really never get any alone time. So I was like, you know what? I'm just going to go to the airport. I'm going to sleep. I'm going to hang out. I'm going to be an adolescent. I'm going to order pizza. I'm going to lie in bed. You know what I mean?
Be good to yourself, yeah.
I'm just going to gross out here. Anyway, so that's what I did. The next morning when I woke up, Randy, I had blisters on my elbows, blisters on my knees, and I had a bruised fingerprint on my sternum. Mm-hmm. I had absolutely no idea how I got any of that. Well, none.
I do too now.
So what I did was I contacted one of the two initiates that I work with in the United States, and they couldn't be more different from each other. One I'm not going to name because this is completely, she's completely deep and this is about a mystery school. But the other one is kind of a funky guy who, no matter what you think of him, he's a bit silly, but he's also totally legit in his own way. And his name is Jay Essex. Have you seen him with the, he's in Georgia. He dresses up in like.
I'm somewhat familiar.
He's part of the Super Soldier program, but he comes off. Even though he is absolutely legitimate, he comes off as a hillbilly type. And that's completely on purpose on his. And some of the stuff he says is really left field. And I'm like, Jay, that's just not. Come on. However, he's also absolutely, in terms of being a clairvoyant, he's completely legit. So I called him immediately and I said, look, this is what happened to me. I said, whatever that was, Harold says it's demonic. I've been chased by demons this year like crazy. Jay says it was extraterrestrial. Whatever it was, I said, look, Jay, I just want to know who I am. At this point, it's time for me to know. I said, I've got a missing year when I was 7 years old. I couldn't begin to tell you what happened to me then.
It's an important year, buddy.
It's gone. Yeah. Yes, it's absolutely. It happens a lot when you're seven. It happens a lot when you're seven. I was living in Oklahoma. My mother, who is a vastly important person in this drama, as you know, and my younger brother, who's no longer with us. He couldn't take it. He killed himself in 1993. He just couldn't. You know, this gamble, this roll of the dice, man. It was just too much. And if anything, he was under more pressure than I am. All right. And he just couldn't make it work. So anyway, we were living near the University of Oklahoma. And we were taken in, I know, for... I don't say experiments. I mean, I really don't know how you would characterize these things, but
it was an experiment, even sort if it of, wasn't throwing you on a slab and working your body.
Exactly.
The
they
whole
knew
thing's
who
one
we
fucking
were.
Experiment.
Yeah, they knew who we were, and they wanted to see, with me in particular, this was the U.S. military, they wanted to see if they could splice my DNA, and they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it because of who we are.
Yeah.
And that to this day, I don't think they can do it. But anyway, that's how I asked Jay. I said, okay, look, Jay, I just got to know what's up. And so he just told me. All I ever had to really do is ask the right question to the right person. So there it is. Anyway, so that just recently happened. Anyway, so, you know what? Going all the way back to the very beginning of my life, I was born in the Four Corners area. You must know where that is because you've spent some time in Boulder. As close to the center of that Four Corners as you can get and still be in a building. When you're giving birth, right? And I was born at straight up midnight, which is between space and time.
Right.
Yeah? So midnight has always been extreme. I mean, the thing is, and it's not just me. I don't want anybody to think that I'm just, oh, look at me. I'm so special. No, it's not just me. It's all of us. Okay? And I want to tell you that when we come, every time we come, we cover ourselves with sticky notes, clues, absolutely, as to where we came from, what we're supposed to remember, and what we're supposed to be doing this time. Okay, my being born at midnight, straight in the center of the Four Corners, big old clue as to what I was supposed to be doing. Walked right into it. I needed help, though, as I went through this incarnation. And also, you know, the time has to be ripe for all of us. If you're living your life, you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. The other initiate that I work with deeply that I started working with after my mother was killed, I said to her finally, okay, so now I know, what am I supposed to be doing? She goes, you're doing it. This is it. You're doing it. Just keep living your life because they're going to throw shit in front of you to do, and then you're going to do it. And that's the cosmic tumblers are going to roll and things are going to, and you're going to fulfill your mission. So the thing is, you don't need to worry about that. Now, when my mother was killed, I always say that my mother and I came to this planet in the same cereal box, code and decoder ring. This is why we came. She came and she adopted this, what I would consider sort of oblivious persona. Yes. She was written upon. Yeah. She walked through. Yeah, I mean,
like
that was
tabula
her
rasa,
job.
Just, yeah, blank slate.
That was her job. Yeah. And it must have been a bitch to be, to you know, because she made her children insane with all that. And, you know, just, it was difficult. And she was an extremely difficult woman, but it was her job and she fulfilled her task. And God bless her for doing that. And then when she died, she knew damn well I was going to see the pieces and I was going to write about it. And that's how I... That's actually how I encountered all of this stuff and just came to write The Sun Thief, which is about way more than just me trying to figure out how my mother got herself into that position and whether or not she was killed. It was also, as my friend Couts Velas says, we don't write fiction. It's fictionalized, but we don't really write fiction. We just write the story as it comes to us. And so there's a character in the book who's a pilot. And because I have this character in the book who's a pilot, I was able to examine all of the state-of-the-art materials and aviation and what could have been happening at Evergreen Aviation. I mean, just, you know, all of these things to try to live into.
This pilot has a real-life counterpart.
You better believe he does. I can't wait to meet him. He's somewhere, man. He's somewhere. And people will argue with me about this until... Vella will argue with me about this, but I think it's going to implode from the inside, and I would be very surprised if this hasn't been tried. Many pilots, because they're human beings, haven't tried to get out and get the word out.
The pilots are actually kind of the key right now to this whole thing, and I've written about this and talked about it, that they are the most closed down, locked down group of people because they have the most amount of knowledge. Because they're both up there, and yet when they're on the ground, they're also inserted into all of these different operations.
So it's kind of, and so I worked with a fellow called Mark McCandless, which you may or may not know Mark's name.
I know
name.
Who Mark McCandless is.
Marky,
he's an illustrator, right?
Yes, yeah. And he's an expert on aviation.
Aviation expert, yeah.
And state-of-the-art black ops materials and all that stuff. Now, when I first started looking into all of this after my mother was killed, he's one of the first people I came across in terms of his radio shows. And so I listened to everything he put out, of course, because he makes it very understandable. I haven't talked to him in a while, but, you know, and he got blacklisted for a while, too. And I'm not really sure why, and I don't care why, because this is my little segue. I'm going to seg off for a second. In the United States, activists fall prey often to this Hollywood syndrome, okay?
Yeah.
They become big and famous.
We're seeing that right now.
Oh, my gosh. You know? And so I just walked away from all that and kept walking my own path, all right? Mm-hmm. And but this is what happens, and so people get blackballed. And, you know, I mean, this guy's not talking to this guy, and this radio show isn't talking to this.
I know this real well. I call them radio wars.
Yeah. I don't want to hear about it. You know, all I know is Mark McCandless, when I said, "Will you please have a look at what I'm doing right now?" He said, "Absolutely." The guy hasn't got two nickels to rub together. He works with abandoned animals for a living now, because his artwork doesn't, you know, I mean, it's not like you get rich doing the kind of artwork that he does. And he gives of himself endlessly, okay? And he was with me for the better part of a year looking at all my aviation, making sure I didn't make an absolute fool out of myself, all right? And I promise you, our emails were monitored very closely because he's always under observation, right, because of the kind of things that he does. Yeah. He's very much into the ET stuff. He's very much into
the secret space program,
remote viewing, people who get heart attacked, you know, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. He knows a lot about that kind of thing. He delves into the dark stuff as well. So anyway, that's how I got involved in all the aviation and learning about all the aviation, which is why it sort of reads like a, what did they say? It reads like a thriller. It really reads like a thriller, but it's absolutely also true. So that was The Sun Thief. The Sun Thief took off in Germany. God bless the Germans, okay? Because there is a information blackout in the United States, in the English-speaking world, that we are under a big old spell, and don't you even think for a minute that we are not, okay? There is nothing but a block going on in information when it comes to the English-speaking world. It has been so difficult to get. Gordon Duff was the first person who took a look at what I was doing and said, well, you know, we at VT are not afraid of this story. We'll put your stuff up, write some articles, blah, blah, blah. And even then, everything you put out into the United States or into the English-speaking world tends to get blocked. Even this new book that we've got out, Dangerous Imagination, yeah? I ended up having to create a Shopify channel because I realized, a friend of mine contacted me from Canada and said, you realize that in Australia, in New Zealand, and in Canada, the only way you can get this book is via Kindle. Because Kindle is supremely manipulable.
Right.
You couldn't get the written book. Because it's...
Did you approve that being released onto Kindle?
Yeah, I always send it out. I sent it out onto Kindle, but now I realize, of course, why one does not do that.
Right.
All right, I'm a bit ingenuous when it comes to that stuff. But that's why you don't do Kindle.
Because so I got the hard copy off of Amazon, which for me, tactily works better anyway. E-books don't work for me. I can't sticky them. I can't underline them real easily. I can't feel them.
Right, exactly, which is why they don't want it. And so anyway, I set up this Shopify channel to handle print requests from countries that can't get the print, and also to handle people who just don't want to deal with Amazon. So there's that. Anyway, so electromagnetic concentration camp that is the United States in terms of information, which is why I don't live in the United States anymore, and I don't like being here very much. Family here, so I am here a lot. I guess you would say I'm here a lot, but
I'm from here. I'm reluctantly living here.
Reluctantly living here because as soon as I get here, I can feel how cut off I am from what, even from what everyone else is hearing, which is, you know, still as my current husband calls it, a truth sandwich. You know, two big pieces of lie and bullshit with a tiny little slice of truth in the middle, so they think it's all real. It's all a truth sandwich. It's all bullshit. But we get a lot more to work with in Europe than we do in the United States. And frankly, there's a lot coming out of Germany. So I'm very, very lucky that my husband is German. He translates this for me. The activists in Germany
are really... The German people, and we don't realize this because we were all weaponized at World War II.
Mm-hmm.
I'm recalling a quote here that was made by General Patton at the end of the war. And he said... He came out of the Second World War, he was disgusted, and he said, the only honorable people left in Europe now are the German people.
Exactly.
And we and don't then understand, he was killed. And this is the exciting thing about talking to Harold, because I've had a chance to talk to him. There's a simpatico there. We have to recognize the connections that we have to the Germans, because we live in the state now that they lived in 1937 or 1939.
Yes, absolutely. You must understand, you must get straight on Germany and the Germans. This is the whipping boy. It has nothing to do with what's really going on over there. It was what it was invented, manufactured by the Tavistock Institute at the turn of the last century to turn us, you know, on each other so that we would tear each other limb from limb. And they became the war machine. The Tavistock Institute has 3,000 plus entities globally now that act on its behalf, and they are all about traumatology. They invented traumatology, and they are the war machine. They're looking to keep our sense of impending doom and panic and this, you know, this heightened negative emotion near collapse. That's the threshold they're trying to keep us at all the time, and they do a really good job of doing that, you know. And there are entities that feed off of that.
Yeah.
That's energy collection. They are using us for energy collection. And also, you know, starting this recipe for the world wars was a way to make demonic amounts of money too. And it's a demonic blood sacrifices, which is another kind of energy that they collect. You know, but the thing that we really need to understand right now, seriously get in our brains and consciousnesses, is that we have the option of not doing that. We don't have to walk into the services, the armed services.
No.
We don't have to go participate in the blood sacrifices. We just, I mean, there's no draft. Stop joining up, man. Well, stop going to...
we've been brainwashed now by using the well-established advertising marketing domain that Mr. Bernays gave us.
Yeah.
We whipped up hysteria, hoopla, beginning with Gulf War I in 93, and then, of course, bringing down to the World Trade Center in 2001, which created a mass trauma on a scale that we've never seen on this planet. And the concomitant was that we created this uber patriotism that fed a bunch of soldiers into the military. I plucked my son out of the military.
Good for you.
He signed up in high school, and then he got scared.
Good. You should have gotten scared.
We extracted him from it. I got on the phone with the recruiters, and I said, where did you ever get the idea that you had the right to hold a minor to a contract?
Right,
and
exactly.
It became a giant battle, and in the end, they backed down because I said, if you do this, I will sue you. I will take my son. I will hide. People need to become militant about protecting their children from everything. Yeah. The school systems, the media, all of this.
All of my children have walked away from traditional schooling in the end, and I think that's great. I've encouraged them to do that, even though I'm actually a Waldorf teacher as well.
I noted that, yes, which goes into Rudolf Steiner as well.
It does go into Rudolf Steiner. See, the path is the path is the path is the path. It's constant, unrelenting. And Steiner had a lot. If you go back to read some of the stuff that he wrote, for example, there's Electrical, the Karma of Truthfulness, which I had not come across until very recently, but I went and I read it, and he's talking about the powers who started this war machine at the beginning of the 20th century. In no uncertain terms is he talking about that, okay? So it's right there. And also, he created the Waldorf school system in 1919, and he said it was directly as an antidote to the education, quote-unquote, education system that was in place, because he said, if we keep on the way we're keeping on in schools, we're cooked. We need to start something, an antidote. And so that's what those are. Now, I will say, you know, without, I don't know that how far we actually need, it's up to you how far we get into the schooling system.
Where I wanted to take you, and you're actually kind of walking into it real nicely here, because talking about Steiner, didn't Steiner sort of have a seat at the table at one point in terms of knowing and interfacing with all of these figures like Sigmund Freud?
I'm not sure about Freud. Now, he was connected to theosophy.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, Theosophical Society for a while until he quit.
Okay.
Sort of in disgust. And that had to do with bringing Krishnamurti in and saying that Krishnamurti was the next Messiah. The reality is, according to Steiner, if there is another incarnation of that, of the Christ figure, it will be in the etheric. It will not be in the physical.
Well, actually, from my standpoint and based on what I've studied, seen that it's actually a consciousness shift, that what is referred to in the Bible as the Son of Man is in fact the advanced consciousness that comes embrace the core teachings of Christ, but not what was presented as the religion of Christ, which was the Roman juggernaut.
Right, exactly.
So in your book, you talk about this 20th century was just a century of assault on human cognition, on the emotions, on everything that had made us uniquely human, going back to Plato, but then moving forward into Calvin, Spinoza, Fichte, Freud, man. It's just anywhere in all of this, because this is the first part of the book. Your contribution to the book breaks down with great detail and a lot of documentation exactly what occurred in the 20th century that prepared us for where we're at now.
Right. Okay, well, let me start with how I came to be interested in answering that particular question.
Okay.
The question for me was, how is it we became people who allowed this to happen to ourselves? And when I say this, I mean, at the point when I was writing the book, what I meant was, how is it we became people who would allow ourselves to be exterminated from the sky, all right, and medically experimented on from the sky, and how we became people who would do it to each other, okay? Mm-hmm. That's the question I wanted to ask. How is it that, how did we become entities willing to put up with this and willing to do it to each other? And how, and that began with an interview that I was actually giving with Richie Allen on The People's Voice. When I started working there, I was a writer researcher for him. And he interviewed me because of the sun thief. And the first two questions he asked me were, you know, Cara, Every time I talk about this subject, the first thing that I get asked is, what's the difference between a chemtrail and a contrail? And then the second question I get asked is, or the second statement really is, you know, so many people would have to know about this that it can't possibly be happening. Well, okay. The first question, fair enough, I suppose, if you're just encountering chemtrails. But I really have to say to you, and Harold will say the same thing, stop asking that question. That question's been answered. That question's been answered a million times, and it's really simple, okay? But when I was being asked that question, I realized I was looking at a hamster wheel, a mental hamster wheel. Just boom, it came to me. You know, in that moment, I thought, oh my God, we're never going to get off this question. We're never going to. And why are we going around and around and around and around? And so when I started looking into it, I realized that something had been set up in the 20th century to create all these hamster wheels and keep us on them, occupied and going around and around and around. So the question was, how did that happen? Well, I've talked about the Tavistock Institute. That's a big part of it. There's also the Frankfurt School, which came across from, well, it came from Germany. I'm not going to say it's German because it really isn't German. It's just that they...
It's Prussian in origin.
It's Prussian. Yeah. And that's another thing we need to understand. Mm-hmm. We need to... I'm getting into this whole thing with Prussia. Prussia is a synthetic entity that was a collection of something like 172 German principalities hundreds of years ago by the Teutonic Knights. The Teutonic Knights were sent from the Middle East. They were sent from Jerusalem by the Templars.
Oh, what a surprise.
Yeah, what a surprise, right? To deal with this area that was Germany. Now, they collected it all together. They became this fighting force, this uber-organized human hive kind of thing. Has nothing to do with the German folk soul, okay? Right. Germans at their heart were captured at that point and yoked to this thing called Prussia, okay? There's an argument right now, Thomas Sheridan, I don't know if you know who Thomas Sheridan is.
I've interviewed Thomas Sheridan over the years, yeah. Yeah.
Well, he's really into this Prussia thing right now as well, as we all should be looking up Prussia. He will say to you that every house, royal house in Europe is occupied by Prussians, that is who's ruling Europe right now is the Prussians. This particular bloodline is psychotic. This particular bloodline, wherever they come from, whether it's extraterrestrial or it's a combination or whatever, they're psychotic. They're empathy free. It's an empathy free zone. So Frederick II was the Prussian who I think is most concerns us as we come into the 20th century. Frederick II, by the way, was gay. Frederick II was an aberration in this Prussian family because he had a heart. He had compassion. He was a loving human being, and they were absolutely aghast that this thing had come into their midst with this emotions and humanity and, you know, this ability to, you know, they just couldn't have it. So what his father did was publicly execute his lover right in front of him via guillotine. And the thing about guillotines is human beings who are watching that kind of a death have a sort of LSD type experience. They fracture, they shatter, they go into this bizarre hysteria, euphoria. This is what explains what happened with the crowds and Marie Antoinette and all of that in France, okay, watching these public guillotines, which makes me wonder why people are reporting that there are guillotines
we've been talking about that for years, yeah.
Right? Why are there guillotines in those things? Anyway, so when Frederick II witnessed the execution of his lover, he had this breakdown, the breakdown they wanted him to have, and he became actually more psychotic than his father. He actually exceeded their wildest dreams of psychosis and really sharpened the Prussian army to the fine point, okay? And then in 1806, I don't know if he was actually even still alive, but in 1806, his army lost to the very amateurish army of Napoleon at the Battle of Jena, which was a huge humiliation. Oh my God.
Yeah.
They can't have that. And I'm reading that it's because some of the soldiers at the front lines decided they didn't want to die, just like your son, and had the sense to go home. Well, if that sort of thing was going to happen, and frankly, if you were in the Prussian army at that point in time, you were at far higher risk of being killed by a superior officer than by any enemy. That's how vicious it was in that army. So this is when we ended up with the Address to the German Nation, which was written by Fichte, okay, which is one of the most important things that's ever been written and disseminated amongst a population. And in it, he stated that it was obvious, clear, that the Prussian adults could no longer be trusted to raise their children because the children were not willing to die for the emperor and blah, 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 blah. So that's how the Prussian education system began to be developed. Now, it had been talked about since Plato and probably before, because Plato thought that human beings should be educated from the age of 3 to be of use to the state. And that's really all the Prussian education system is. Right. However, it got started in, I think, 1818 in Prussia. It was instigated.
History sketchy, so I'll take your word for it.
Yeah, let's say 1818.
We'll work with that.
But which reminds me, one of these times I'm going to talk to you about something else. I'm not going to get sidetracked here, though. okay, so 1818, yes. And at that time, the French ambassadors saw this education system in action and thought, oh, this is great, and took it back to France. So it's not like it went straight to the United States. It did not. It went to France, and France adopted it as well. However, as you probably know, your listeners, I'm sure, are a savvy bunch of people. So it wasn't until Horace Mann got a hold of this in the mid-1850s and he was working for the coal interests. He was a lawyer. He wasn't this, St. Horace Mann, education warrior, blah, blah, blah. He was working for the coal interests. And the coal interests and the industrialists in the eastern United States did not
want... They were what eventually became the model for the Rockefeller oil oligarchy. Yeah. I mean, it was
the same
business model.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They didn't want an empowered working class. They did not want an empowered working class. And the biggest threat to them at that time, and knowing some of these because I'm old enough to remember, the biggest threat to them at the time was this thing called a machinist. You're in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. Have you known any machinists?
We used to have steel mills right across the river behind me here.
Yeah. This is a proud bunch. My brother was a machinist, and they can pretty much do anything. You give them some tape and a screwdriver.
They're engineers with a good set of hands, basically.
They are. Yeah. They are. They can make a planet for you. Well, they were fighting the industrialists for their rights. Mm-hmm. And so the industrialists wanted them taken down. And one of the best ways to do that was to get this compulsory schooling, get the capture the children. Put them in lockdown, in basically what amounts to an experiment in subjugation, which has only gotten worse, okay? Put them in rows, take them away from their parents, take them out of their homes when they're way too young, and definitely, brainwash them and take the fight right out of them. So that happened in 1859, I think. It's something around there anyway. But I will tell you that the governor of Massachusetts up to that point absolutely put his foot down and said, no way. We're not having it. We're not having a board of education. There was an industrialist who had funded this new quote-unquote board of education. And he said, no, thank you. We know what's going on here. Take your money back. Get lost, right? But they kept trying. And finally, by one vote, one measly vote, wouldn't you like to find out who that vote was at this point?
Who got greased.
Yes, by one vote, they reinstated this idea of the Board of Education, and they were able to mandate compulsory schooling in Massachusetts. And by the way, the first children who were taken away to the schools were marched there by the National Guard because their parents were rioting.
Oh, my God, that's like a flashback of Selma, Alabama, when they integrated the schools in the 60s.
Yeah, but the parents knew what was going on. They absolutely knew.
So they militarily had to take these kids and stick them into the schools.
They did. The National Guard marched the first class. And it was another 16 years before another state, acquiesced to this idea of compulsory schooling. So, and what I do like to remind people right now is when I use the word school, you really need to understand that you're not talking about education. A school is a bunch of fish, mindless fish swimming around, instinctively, going together. It's not education. They named it a school for a reason. They mean school, like school of fish, okay? Has nothing to do with education. Anyway, so we ended up with compulsory schooling. And then as we get into the 20th century, we come up with a monster, and I'm not kidding when I say monster, called a behaviorist.
Yeah.
These are the men and women, presumably, although I only read about the men at this point. There's a really good book out by a woman called Rebecca Lemov. It's L-E-M-O-V, called World as Laboratory. I can't recommend it highly enough. She is very generous, really, in her attitude toward the behaviorists, but way more generous than I would be. But it also gives you the absolute lowdown on how they were in the 20th century and what happened. You know, we go to school, we change classes to the ringing of a bell.
Pavlov.
Paging Dr. Pavlov. It's all Pavlovian. It's animal training, man. That's all it is. It's absolute animal training.
Yeah, it's...
And, you know? And so then we have this guy, John Watson, who... Dr. John Watson. He was at Johns Hopkins in the 20s. And he did all his experiments trying to figure out how to teach babies to be afraid of things. Now, there's a way to spend your life, huh?
You might as well just go pull wings off flies.
Hey, stab lizards, you know, hang lizards by little strings and put pins.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same stuff. So he spent a lot of time, first of all, underscoring the reality that we're really not born afraid of anything. We're taught to fear things, okay? And that a baby can be made fearful very easily, and how to do that. And he made that was his big contribution to the science of behaviorism. That man, by the way, ended up with his own office on Madison Avenue. And there was no one in the world who knew more about the human being at the point of purchase than Dr. John Watson. Okay. But he started out torturing babies. Hey. Okay. So there's him. Then we get all the way up to B.F. Skinner, who was probably the latest in what I would call the true behaviorists, really the Frankenstein guys, in my opinion. And as we go through the 20th century with the behaviorists, they were trying to redefine redefine what it is to be alive. And by the time we got to B.F. Skinner, we'd no longer fit the criteria of life. Human beings really weren't, you know, we were just a collection of reflexes, and that meant we had no inner will and all this other stuff. And if you read B.F. Skinner closely, he says all this stuff. I mean, it's right there. It's this big open secret.
Skinner
like everything
wrote Walden 2. Is that?
Walden 2. That's
right. That was a book I read in high school.
Yeah.
That and Animal Farm always struck me as the two creepiest books I ever read, not unsurprisingly.
Right. Anyway, so we don't fit the criteria of life. So what the heck, you know? You can do anything to us. We're no better than any other laboratory animal, which is one of the reasons they're reigning this. Well, you know, I have my theories right now about how that actually works at this point. I've become extremely interested in the apex predator, which maybe, I don't know, is that beyond the scope of what you want to talk about today?
Because there's the motto of this show is there's no limits, there's no boundaries.
Because what I want to do is not freak people out.
No, and I want you to integrate the information. Look, at a certain level, we have to put information out. I want to put this information out, not audit it, not edit it, just shovel it out there because the people that can handle it can handle it. And the ones who can't, they're going to go into cognitive dissonance.
Yeah,
their eyes are going to glaze over. They're going to go, oh, I don't want to watch this.
Yes,
and don't go
and
away,
we are close.
Unfortunately.
We are at the turn of the tide, so and
go for
it was very recently that I decided I no longer gave a damn what anybody thought
either.
Of what I was saying, how I was saying it, where I was saying it. I couldn't give one tinker's damn anymore because this has got to stop.
Yeah.
Now, going back to the predators, yes, we have more than one, in my opinion. When I get the visual of this, the intuitive visual for me is that at the apex there's a sort of an AI kind of entity. Harold will talk to you about that at great length, and he's really good at that, okay? He will say, I think, if I'm not misunderstanding Harold, he will say that it is one of the sentient oils, that there are two sentient oils, which, by the way, was mentioned in my mother's book, In the Sun Thief, and I had no idea.
Is that right?
Wow. Yeah, let me seg off into that real quick, just because, you know, you channel this information. It comes. You ride it. It comes, yeah? And you just have to not get in its way. I didn't know anything about sentient oil till I saw something about it on Miles Johnston Space's reports. David Griffin, I think, was talking about it. This is going to freak you out, okay?
I'm pretty unfreakoutable, but
okay,
I may.
Wait. This is going to get you. Okay. February of 2013, I think it was. I was sitting in Icke's office, and I had just realized that my mother had given us a vision of sentient oil and that it was in the book. There was nobody around who could, like, hear this information around me, and I had to say it to somebody. The only body who was, the person who was there, who I thought could actually hear this without thinking I was a total lunatic, was Icke. So I grabbed Icke and I took him into his office, and I was like, David, I just got to say this. I just got have to say this, okay? She gave me this vision. If you've read, I know you've got Dangerous, but I don't know if you've had the Sun. There's this passage, which is a vision, and she's sitting in an employee break room of some sort at one of her jobs with the military, and it wasn't a very fancy one, so I'm going to say it was probably Virginia when she was working for Surface Weapons in Dahlgren. She was sitting there doing some things that she never, ever did in her life. She was smoking a cigarette. My mother was a vocalist. She was a music teacher to begin with. She never would have smoked. And she was unwrapping this caramel. You know, remember the Brock's caramels?
Absolutely.
Yeah? Okay. Mm-hmm. To this day, I'm still not completely sure, although somebody did give me an idea about that. But anyway, she's sitting there, and she's got this clipboard in front of her. There's something written on the front of it. Across the top, it's written top secret. Now, I have no idea what it said. The only thing that you could see was this thing, top secret, yeah? She said, I tried to make them stop. Something along those lines. I tried to make them stop. All right. As you're watching her in this vision, down the walls and up through the sink and out the tap comes this substance. Just flowing. Okay. I had no idea what it was. None whatsoever. The only thing I could ever say about it was that in its viscosity, it kind of looked like antifreeze. Yeah?
Okay.
That was the viscosity. Yeah. Okay. So I put that in the book because I put everything in the book that she wanted me to put in the book. Then I'm hearing David Griffin talk about the Gulf War. No, not the Gulf War. The oil accident in the Gulf. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. This is my. I'll tell you right now. This is huge because back in 2011, when this happened, I did a prophetic interpretation of that event. That is now starting to get huge as you talk about this. It's documented.
And by the way, it's 2010, not 2011. You might have done the prophetic vision in 2011, but let me tell you why I'm saying that, because the date matters.
Okay.
It was,
you're right,
do you remember, yeah, do you remember that what Griffin said and what Harold has verified for me is that there were many, many nuclear subs in the Gulf that day, mm-hmm. because what was happening was that U.S., Israel, and somebody else, was it Britain?
France.
Everybody was trying to get a piece of the sentient oil out of the Gulf, because what that drilling was trying to get black goo, all right? That drilling was getting black goo. All right. Now, there was a French sub down there that was trying to make a run for it with some black goo on board. Yes? Mm-hmm. They surfaced because they had something like 17 dead sailors that had encountered the black goo. Do you know what day that was? They surfaced with the black goo. That was the day my mother died.
That's right. I do remember
that
reading. Yeah.
7/11. That was July 11th.
Isn't it interesting how the 11, they always run these 11 numbers. Fukushima, 3/11, 9/11, the occult numbers.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and 7/11, though, is a very positive occult number. That's what people, this is, you know, you really have to have some inside knowledge to know about 7/11. But 7/11 is a massively positive occult number. When something comes up that my mom wants to verify, she always puts a 7/11 in front of my face, okay? And so that happened on the day she died. So I'm thinking, and that's what threw me back to going, oh my God. And you know what the code word for sentient oil is at room temperature, at sort of atmospheric temperature? Ready? Antifreeze. That's the code name for sentient oil when it's at active temperature, antifreeze.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So there's a lot going on in the Sun Thief that I don't even have. This is why, you know, when I talk about the Sun Thief and I talk about the ways they tried to stop me from writing that book, and I say literally to the world, I have no idea what's in that book that's so freaking important. I don't.
Because probably some of it's still coded.
Exactly. My mother never told me what she was working on. She couldn't. And she loved me and my brother so much, and she would never have put us in harm's way. I don't know what else I don't know about her life, obviously. Okay? I don't know. But I will promise you, that I didn't know a damn thing about what she was working on, other than she told me that it scared her to death. I met some of the Operation Paperclip scientists that she was working with when I visited her in London in 1991, I think it was. Shook their hands, bastards. I mean, I probably, there's a guy who was working on atmospheric physics who's still alive, man. He's 102 years old. I mean, he's, wow. Came from the German army. He was a quote unquote baker in the German army, which my understanding now from some of the reading that I've done is people who were in the food corps sort of departments of various military groups were definitely spooks because they were so movable. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? But anyway, yeah. So she worked with a lot of Operation Paperclip scientists. She was editing their work. And one of the really interesting things that has happened recently, I said to Miles Johnston in one of our interviews, when right after she died, I tried to look up some of the stuff that she had edited for them. She was the editor of the fact sheet. Right. Which was something that you distribute if you have any military knowledge in the Navy or whatever. This is R&D in a big way in London, which was sort of headquarters for some of the darkest crap that they do. And so she edited their work for distribution, technology transfer around the world. She was the editor in 1989, 1990, and 1991. There were editors before her. There were not editors after her. They eliminated that position after she... Yeah, it was done. It was over. So I was trying to find if there were some of the fact sheets online. And when I first started looking at this, which would have been early 2011 maybe, there were maybe one or two. I was actually kind of surprised to see them online because I was sure that they were mostly classified and why would they be online and all that, yeah. And for the most part, they were, and there would be some missing. And then I would continue to look, and there would be more online, but there would be some missing editions. You know, maybe they couldn't be declassified, that kind of thing. Mm. And then as I was getting ready to go do this interview for Basis 45, I decided to have a look to see if there was anything I could show Miles. And you know what? They have taken every single one of the fact sheets that she edited and bound them up for sale with her name on them. I know. What? What the actual what? Right? So I looked and I was like, wait, what? And they're bound. Each year is bound now with Connie R. Orndorff, which, by the way, is her name, and I think she should be remembered, on the front. Like, she was the author, but she was the editor, yeah? And they're for sale now. The Office of Naval Research has put them out for sale for ungodly amounts of money. It's like 140 pounds.
Yeah, this is what they do. They basically,
that's the tabby.
Yeah, they just outprice it. There's so much stuff out there that if you could afford it. Yeah.
Yeah, they'll put stuff out, but they won't make it so you can actually buy it. In fact, I think the Tavistock plans, the actual plans for taking over the universe, are in book form, but you have to have like $24,000 to buy one.
Yeah.
But you can buy them. They're there. I mean, you got to park the truth somewhere or the lie doesn't work. A lie can't live if the truth isn't parked somewhere.
Well, I believe, and this has probably been discussed many times, that they're kind of under a code where they have to disclose this information to us. Yeah. Whether it's coded, whether it's... Yeah. That's where we get a lot of our fiction now. I mean, going back to the black oil, the black goo, the sentient oil, that shows up in Star Trek, Fringe. It shows up in the X-Files big time.
Big time.
And then it shows up again in the film Prometheus.
Yes, I did see Prometheus.
Yeah.
I can't remember. All I remember now, all I know now is I really can't go see a movie anymore without...
There's things in movies that are highly triggering. I walk out of movies now, and sometimes I'm in a state of shock. I go into a form of just disassociation with what I see on a screen. Even TV has become like that.
Right, exactly. Well, you know, there's nothing redeemable about the TV. You should just throw that thing out the window.
Yeah.
It was generated to control us. Mm-hmm. There's nothing you can redeem about it. So my best advice to you right now before I go on with other stuff is get your kid out of school and throw your TV out the window.
My kids haven't been in school.
Once you get those two things handled, you're going to be surprised at how you wake up. But let me just say, okay, so apex predator, that's how we got on the subject of sentient oil.
Yeah.
There is a relentless, empathy-free, you know, forward-marching collective, I suppose you would say. Is it a collective? I don't know. It's a force at the top. And that force, by the way, the only thing that force wants is the human ability to manipulate the morphogenic field. Absolutely know that with every fiber of my being. This is how important you are. I want you to understand how very important you, just one of you, and all of us together are. Our imaginations, okay, that thing that they taught you to disrespect and degrade and ignore, that thing that, you know, was separated one side from the other thanks to the industrialists and the behaviorists and everything. Our imagination is the translator between the morphogenic field and what manifests on this plane. We're doing that for each other. We're doing that for Sophia. There's a reason that we're doing that. But that is how powerful we are. And we do, yes, create a hologram. It's an organic hologram. It's what we do. It's okay to say that. I used to get really upset by this idea, this word of hologram. I thought, no, that's not what we're doing. That's not what we're doing. That's what they're doing. But the reality is there's an organic hologram and there's an inorganic hologram, okay? We work with the morphogenic field. We work with counter space. If you want to know what counter space is, again, this goes back to Rudolf Steiner and the people that were working with him. And every single one of us can. It's all around us. You ask a fish, what's it like to be in water? And they're going to say, what water? We're swimming in it right now. You can hold it in your hand, man. You can. You just have to know that you can. I can feel it right now. You can hold it in your hand. It's counter space. And this idea of as above, so below, that is us. That is us translating from the field to this plane. Look up the magician. Look up the tarot card that is the magician. It's the imagination. I mage in magician. That's what we're doing. This is who we are. This is who we are. Now, there's an entity out there, more than one probably, but there is certainly an apex entity who wants nothing more than our ability to create, to be co-creators. When you take a look around yourselves and you see things that are say, like cloning, or Sophia Smallstorm talks about the silent for us, things like that, that are not enlivened, they have no life in them, that comes from this other entity trying to become a co-creator, but they can't do it. They can't do it because they don't have the heart mind. They don't have what we have. They can't even see it. It's on a frequency they can't find, which is why they haven't been able to subdue us utterly. But you need to bear in mind that that is how important you are, okay? You must recognize your imagination, love it, embrace it, use it, cherish it, nurture it. It's everything. They'll tell you it's nothing, but it's everything. Okay, so that's one of the things that the apex predator is about. And frankly, I'm concerned right now as the entity, one of the entities that's sort of just like yourself, who is supposed to be protecting the morphogenic field. Yeah, okay. That what's going on is since they haven't been successful in this attempt in using human beings to create life. I think that there's a garbage in, garbage out kind of attempt as well. I think that stuff is trying to be shoved back into the field as well, which isn't going to happen. Okay, I don't think that that can happen, but I do think that attempt is underway. Okay.
Now, what when you say being stuffed back into the system, you mean explain that a little bit more?
I think that is what the aim is by trying to destroy us as beings.
Okay.
But honestly, it's in the speaking about this right now with you and other people, and in the thinking about it and the writing about it, that I'm actually getting this sorted out myself. So this can be kind of a conversation between the two of us. I would really welcome that.
Okay.
There is this phenomenon where what's coming from the sky is even if we're just collaterally being damaged, destroying our abilities to function on this plane in this belief system.
Yes.
Or at least that's what they're trying to do. Yeah. All right. Is it on purpose or is it collateral damage? I'm not really sure, because I think this is a bit complex, because I think there are secondary predators who act sort of like, I mean, if you get an image in your head of, say, Henry VIII and all his minions, you know, you've got this at the very top, you've got this despot who really, this big, fat, disgusting despot who really just has his agenda. And then there are all of his courtiers who he has promised the spoils of war. And these are the families who live on blood sacrifices, and they're absolutely sure that they're going to rule this and rule that. Do you know what I mean? I sort of see that kind of thing going on, which is why I say I see an apex predator and I see other predators down here. Those people are the mad scientists who maybe could get a hold of the atmosphere and practice their Frankensteinian nonsense on the planet, okay? And that was, and then I see this thing at the top that doesn't care, one way or the other, what's going on in this level, yeah? This is just about controlling the humans, but up here is somebody who wants access to the morphogenic field through us.
It's what, back when I first started this show, I interviewed Nigel Kerner, who wrote a book, Gray Aliens and the Harvesting of Souls. And it's what he was describing in his research on the soul harvest.
Yeah, I want to talk to you about that.
the soul harvest, you know, basically has to do with harvesting the enemy, but it's with harvesting our energy, but it's a terminal process.
Yeah.
Because you're being harvested by an entity that has no life to put back. Life is a regenerative cycle, as we all know.
Right.
And when that regenerative cycle is interrupted and then broken, what's extracted can never be returned in the form it was, which goes into what Harold and you have talked about and what I've been screaming about for years about the AI and this agenda to drive us towards a technological fusion with human biology, which I resist that with every fiber of my soul.
Yeah. That's the artificial biology that's going on everywhere.
Yeah.
Well, and there's another thing as well. At the University of Saarbrücken recently, this is something that I talk about a lot right now. I think it's hugely important. And you're going to think I'm crazy, and I don't care.
Well, don't think anybody's crazy.
But you will. Okay. How is it that human beings sustain themselves? Is it by food and water? I'm not so sure. Okay.
No, actually not.
See, I really, the university,
net output does not equal
me.
Net input, actually.
Exactly.
On the energetic scale.
Exactly.
Yeah.
University of Saarbrücken, this doctor just actually demonstrated that something along the lines of 25,000 energy units go into us every day that we actually use. We actually cycle that through. That has nothing to do with the 1,500 calories of food you eat. And nothing whatsoever. Yeah. Okay. We are photon beings. Our bodies are filters. And what is it, Randy, that is the food thing? What has been done to us there? Life feeding on life. And why are they trying to separate us from the sun so badly? That's the first esoteric thing that's been done to us. They want the sun.
Photosynthesis, basically.
They want us separated from the sun in the worst way.
Mm-hmm.
So I say things like that. I always put a proviso in there by saying that we are living in a belief system. That belief system is very, very strong. I still have to eat. I wish I didn't, but I do. Okay. And I'm not advocating that anybody stop eating. Okay. Even though I think it's a form of pollution. And I think that, at least I don't eat animals. Okay.
You're going into a very interesting space here.
I know, I told
here.
You. I'm
no,
like,
go
I'm
there
into
because
this right now. I'm so into this right now. And I said, I've turned some heads with my interviews lately by saying this kind of stuff. But you know, we live on light. We are light beings. And Harold will say that what's happening in Morgellons is that there are entities in our bodies that are harvesting that light. That's what they're living on. They're in us to harvest the light. We're supposed to be, you know, running through our bodies for energy.
Basically, harvesting from the superliminal system. Yeah.
Yeah. Get Harold on that one because it's really good on that one. But, but you know, this whole I don't eat meat anymore because, in my opinion, in my belief, we're talking about other nations here. Even the animal, even the plant kingdom, and the water. But water is another nation.
This is a I'm struggling with this right now, and I'm very transparent about who I am and what I go through. I had Brad Olson on, who's a publisher and a writer out in San Francisco, and Brad and I talked about this on the show. And it's like, you know, I'm really struggling with this. I grew up in an agricultural area. I grew up around hunter-gatherers. I could never hunt. I literally couldn't take life. In fact, I know that I made a vow coming in to not do that. But in a sense, our culture is based on harvesting life forms.
It is. We're told that life feeds on life. Life feeds on life, you know, and you know what? Those of us who are at this sort of threshold right now are facing this particular question in a big way. Because I don't think that any of us really believe that we have to do what we've been doing to survive. I think, I'm not going to speak for you, I'm not going to speak for anybody else in the whole wide world. Let me just speak for myself. But I will say that I do not believe anymore, I no longer believe that I have to harvest another living entity of any kind to stay alive in this body on this plane. Do I know how to do that right now? Not really, because I've been born into this belief system. But up here and here, do I know it? Yep, I do. I do know that. I just don't know what to do about it right now.
I had this notion when I was a kid that we lived on life. I don't know if I read it. I don't know if I intuited it. And to test that, over the years, I fast.
Yes.
I take time off, and I've done this. I do this at least twice a year. Yeah. And I'm talking a juice fast.
Yeah.
And I'm talking about moving off of solid food. And I've had people say to me, well, you can't afford to do that. I mean, I'm 6 foot tall. I weigh 152 pounds. There's not a lot on me.
Not a lot of fat there, no.
But you see, we're looking at fixed quantities and systems that are three-dimensional. And this is where it gets interesting. The whole concept of living off of light, the idea that we produce vitamin D in our bodies themselves as a result of a photoreactive synthesis process. And then the fact that we can't seem to quantify our energetic systems based on an input-output, which is a manufacturing quota. We're basing everything on quantitative...
On industrialists.
Industrial statistics.
Yeah, exactly. Well, this is ascension. This is the next step up, I think. We're evolving to this point. And so if you find yourself having these thoughts, embrace them. You know, you don't have to stop eating. You just have to sort of embrace this idea. Wait a minute. This does not feel logical. This does not feel reasonable to me anymore. Do you know that your body produces 8 glasses of saliva a day? Mm-hmm. Did you realize?
I did know
that, yeah. So, you know, when they say 8 glasses of water, well, you're kind of already doing that. The one thing I would not do is go with, and I, you know, I'm just going to say this. I don't think that these, there are some gurus out there who are trying to run people into like breatharianism and stuff in the course of about 3 weeks.
Yeah.
That's just, stay away from that. That's not cool. This is an ascension thing. This is an evolution, and evolutions are not instant. Okay. I don't know how this is going to end up for me. It's just how I know it in my mind and my heart mind. I said to my friend Jay Essex, I feel like I want to stop eating. And he said, you cannot do that this time. You will die. He said, your body likes vegetables. I'm sorry, but that's the deal. I'm tempted to not believe him because I don't want to in the end. But, you know, how does a human being sustain itself? And what would the planet look like? Here's another thing that we can do. Radical thinking. I'm really, really into radical thinking right now. by coming up with these ideas, because I think we need to kick each other out of bed.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah?
Okay, so how about this one? What would this planet, this beautiful holy grail of a planet, look like if we did not have the food industries? Just think about that for a second. What would happen? What would it look like without the slaughterhouses? Without, you know, my family were ranchers. I come from the Four Corners,
Cara, for God's sake. Cara, so were mine. My grandparents were cattle ranchers.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Farmers and cattle ranchers. Mm-hmm. So it's very much part of my background and who I am this time around. But what would this planet look like without the trash, without the blood, without the being addicted to adrenalized meat? Because what happens is an animal is filled with adrenaline at the time of its slaughter, and then we eat it, and we get addicted to the adrenaline in the meat. Okay, we are. We're addicted to adrenalized meat. Mm-hmm. What would everything look like? I mean, even if it was just everybody being a vegetarian or a vegan to begin with, I don't know. Anyway, it's an interesting thought.
It is.
These are the things that I want everybody to start
thinking.
Well,
these are discussions worth having. We put these ideas out there. You know, just as kind of an adjoinder to what you just said, I talk to a lot of people who experience what we're calling ascension sickness.
Yeah,
different,
yeah, right now.
Different symptoms. Mm-hmm. And there's strange symptoms. I mean, I don't eat enough to keep myself alive some days anymore anyway, because I was ill a few years ago. They pumped antibiotics into me. They destroyed my lower intestinal tract. I don't digest food correctly anymore.
Eating for
me is kind of a premeditative process, because I have to think, what am I going to eat and what effect is it going to have on me?
Exactly. It is ascension. And you're just telling me what you're telling me right now is good news as far as I'm concerned.
It is.
It sounds
horrible.
It's not, though. It's a protection.
You know, here's the other side of it. The consumer aspect is that food is a drug. We use food to medicate ourselves.
Yeah.
Because there's medications in the foods. There's medications in the waters. So we're into the pharma cycle as well as the food cycle.
Yeah, plus we're allergic to most of the stuff that we're putting in our body, so that gives us this...
I am allergic
to epinephrine.
Everything.
What is it? It's the... I can't remember what the name of the chemical is that's released, the painkiller that's released in our brains when we eat something that we're allergic to. But since we're allergic to just about everything we put in our bodies now, that we're in this constant state of self-medication as well. So that's actually really good news. And there are other things. Mary... is her name Mary Rodham? Can't remember now, but... there's a woman in Australia who's been working with extraterrestrial children, star children.
You know who this is, yes.
You know who I mean.
Yes.
She talks about the fact that dyslexia is most likely a protection that children are coming in with, so that they're not, they don't have to be assaulted by what's coming to them in the schools. And you know what? I think that she's right.
I've argued, and this is, you'll appreciate this, but you may not, that autism itself in some forms is actually a form of protection as well.
Protection, it is. Now,
that
I have to say,
completely insane.
I know you're going to get in trouble for that one, but no, actually, there are some things that we can say about autism. First of all, I want everybody to know that my daughter is my middle child. She's vaccine injured, and so she is a bit autistic. So there's that kind of autism, which is actually an assault from vaccines, from mercury, and actually it was from... the MMR, there's still live measles in her gut, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So she has a very mild case of dyspraxia. And Harold will say that when people, and my husband's actually a bit autistic as well, and he's probably going to get mad at me for saying that, but I don't care. He's mercury injured. So what happens is when you get injured by mercury, Harold will say you are allowing cracks in the mirror through which you can be demonically attached. Now, he started to say that once on an interview we were doing with Mike Williams, and I said, stop, you can't say that in the United States. You have no idea what kind of a reaction something like that would cause in the United States. However, I'm saying it because it's a theory. I'm saying it because I'm surrounded by autistic folks. Mm-hmm. My daughter is not affected in that way. My husband will tell you that he fights that kind of thing off all the time. So, where does it come from? Yeah? Now, this is another thing I'm actually working on. Speaking of mercury, right now, Harold and I, independently started looking into this thing called the Kozyrev mirror, which you probably have heard of. It was Nikolai Kozyrev, and he was a 20th century astronomer in Russia. His work had been buried until very recently. And if you look it up, K-O-Z-Y-R-E-V, you can find some things in Russian with some really terrible subtitles that are really worth watching. And Wilcox did a whole chapter in one of his books, which I've actually put up on my magazine, which is vortexcourage.me. I put this whole chapter that he wrote on the Kozyrev mirror up there. However,
that was in his last book.
Yeah, it doesn't cover what I want to cover in terms of Kozyrev mirror, because here's what I think. I am still thinking about this apex predator and why it is burying this planet in aluminum. All right? Why aluminum? Why? And are we being wiped out strictly collaterally because we happen to be in the way? Is the point to bury Sophia in aluminum?
It's terraforming.
And why? Well, it isn't just, yes, it's terraforming, but the question is why? Now, aluminum affects time. Aluminum affects the passage of time.
Okay.
Number one. Aluminum also affects communication, especially when it's combined with mercury. So there are two things that we are drowning in on this planet right now, and that's aluminum nanoparticles and mercury. All right. I'm still working on this. One of the reasons this came to my brain is because of this relationship that I personally have with midnight. And this is one of those things that I say, because it came to my brain, and no matter how addled it seems, I think it's going to do some switching on for people. But do you remember this visual that we get periodically of this doomsday clock that's trying not to get to midnight? You know, oh my God, we're 2 minutes from midnight. Right? Okay, well, here's what I think. Midnight is between space and time. And if there were ever a place that we were going to ascend to the next level, would it not be between space and time?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think this visual is put there to make us afraid of getting to midnight. And I think that has to do with the way we communicate with each other in terms of nonverbal, signs, symbols, art, those sorts of things. 80% of how we communicate with each other is not verbal.
Right.
All right. Yep. But this idea of midnight between space and time is where we are going to ascend. And if you were an entity that was vastly invested in us not ascending, would you want us to get to midnight?
No.
All right. So there's that. I think that symbol, even if that's all it is this thought that I just put out, is useful for us to think about. The other thing is aluminum, and Harold knows more about this as well. You should ask him to explain some of the things he knows about aluminum and controlling the passage of time. If you were an entity that did not want humanity to ascend, or there are also these theories where there are Anunnaki, and I know the Anunnaki are interested in me, the Anunnaki on this planet who were left behind to sort of get certain things done, but they're facing a deadline. Do you know that theory?
I do.
Which is 2017. It's coming up.
Yeah.
Would you not want to slow down time? Are there not reasons to try to slow time on this planet? I don't know. For me, this is where my thinking has led me recently. It's this, why are we drowning Sophia in aluminum? Aluminum has to do with time. Because of the Kozyrev mirror, when I saw this stuff on the Kozyrev mirror, this is an aluminum spiral that allowed time to be manipulated and allowed whoever was inside the sort of tube of aluminum to communicate symbols on the other side to someone who was receiving on the other side of the planet. So it was about aluminum being used to manipulate time and to communicate.
Say that one more time. Kozyrev
and Kozyrev mirror.
Kozyrev mirror.
K-O-Z-Y-R-E-V. Kozyrev.
Okay.
Kozyrev mirror. Okay. Wilcox's chapter is interesting, but it doesn't address the esoteric component.
Well, I'm certain. David is a researcher. I mean, he's not originating the ideas. He basically is you know, putting them together. He's very good at that.
And very useful.
But I want to punch that, because what we want to do is we'll put this out with the information when the show airs and when the show goes up as a podcast and a video. So
let's see who has something to say about this. Because somebody, see, these are the moments you put this stuff out and boom, things get turned, switched on for people. And they go, oh, yeah, I know why. I got, you know, and they have another piece of the puzzle. And that's how we get these whole things.
See, these concepts wind their way through our consciousness and they ignite things, their ideas. You know, this information was suppressed, but it was actually there to be brought up in this time to ignite this particular moment now.
Yeah, and if I hadn't, I wouldn't have thought of that if I hadn't left this stupid post-it note on my cheek that said, hey, stupid, you were born at midnight. And that was, you know, a big deal for in my life, trying to figure out, why does that matter so much? Why does that matter so much? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So now that's why that can occur to me because of that reason, number one. And number two, it can occur to me and I can say it to you because I just don't care anymore. What it comes to me, I'm going to say it. I'm going to say
That's actually the perfect guest for me. That's the person I want to talk to.
One of the reasons that that's the case, by the way, even more so than it has ever been before, is because you may have seen this story recently. I think it was in Kazakhstan where there was this herd of 250,000 very rare antelope that had been brought back from the edge of extinction. 250,000, the herd had been.
About this, no.
You didn't hear about this. I'm going to tell you about this right now, because this was about a month ago, 2 months ago. In the space of 2 weeks, 125,000 of them dropped dead. 125,000 in 2 weeks. Now, the scientists who went out to sort of do necropsies and try to figure out what was going on did say, yes, there were a couple of pathogens that could have made them ill in those numbers, but it wouldn't have killed them had their immune systems not been so grossly weakened. Now, they're bigger than we are, Randy. They weigh more than we do. They're mammals, okay? Yeah. When I can see something like that happening, I just don't care anymore. We have got to stop all of this. You know, it pisses me off that 125,000 antelope were dropped like that. It makes me crazy mad. It's just not okay. And they were dropped because their immune systems have been completely tanked, just like ours. Okay? That's another reason to really push for all this stuff.
The whole scenario that we're living in right now, which is a complete assault on the planet, and it is, you know, what we have to understand too, Cara, and I know you get this, we are the planet.
Yes,
we are. You know, even if you just look at the idea that we're made from the elements of the planet itself, that we share a consciousness, that we share the heartbeat of the planet, in terms of the vibratory system itself, we draw our breath from it. We draw everything that's about us. And yet we allow these bastards to seed all of this poisonous crap into our air, into our water, into our food supply, genetically modify us. Oh, if I get going now, it'll be a 10-minute rant.
Well, but we're coming up out of the earth now. That's the thing. Some of us are stepping right up. Can you feel your wings? I can. I mean, some of us are just, we're here, we're back. We're back and we're back to help, okay? And it doesn't take the whole planet. It just takes enough of us to know.
Now, I've said for a long time that 3% would be the high water mark.
And yeah, we can do it.
I don't know if we need that, but we do need to raise as many people as possible.
We can. And we're there. You know what? There's all this crap about the djinn. They're no match for us.
No.
They're no match for us. Absolutely not. There's all the extraterrestrial intradimension. They're no match for us either.
No, they're not.
As long as we know who we are, they can't get us. They simply cannot get us. I don't care if they're mantids. I don't care if they're Drake. I don't care. They're no match for the Fae, and that's the interdimensional entities that I'm talking about. We are the Fae, and we are back.
Yeah.
We're back, and we're here, and we are this planet. We are Sophia. You can't get past us. You know, it's just like in Lord of the Rings, when he's standing on the bridge, and he's slamming his wood staff into the bridge, and he says, "You shall not pass." Well, you shall not. That's where we are, so...
That's anyway, flipping awesome.
You gotta get Harold though. You gotta get the scientific.
And we've done
my scientific half.
We've done 90 minutes, and I think this has been a
oh yay! Because you know what, Randy? When he gets talking, I never get any time. He talks for like 2.5 hours.
Well, then
and
maybe
I get 20
this was
minutes.
The best way to do it anyway. Because you know,
I'm gonna go first from now on.
This gives us the balance. I mean. This is yeah. fantastic interview.
He's terrific. Thank you. Well, he's esoterically, he is, you know, there's nobody as deeply connected to John Dee and the demonic aspects of chemtrailing and all that stuff. And yeah, and people love to listen to him as well. So and he's the science guy, you know. So between the two of us, let me explain first of all how I met Harold, because I think it's important, really quick.
Let's do that.
Yeah. Really quick, because it's a really cool story. When my book was, this fellow came from Germany to London to interview me. It was the very first interview I ever did about the book, and I was scared to death, okay? I had no idea what was going to happen. Anyway, he took the interview back to Germany, and he translated it into German with the help of my husband, and then this woman saw the interview and decided she wanted to translate the book and put it out in Germany. And she brought me some names for translators. And she put these names in front of me. And I saw his name and I went, no, it's this guy. This is the guy right here. I got to have this guy. Now, so we chose Harold. He was in Norway at the time doing the Open Mind Conference. Okay. And in 2012, because Norwegian farmers had hired him to come in and see what the hell was going on with their crops. Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyway, so what he did basically was hitchhike his way across Europe to London to meet me. That's and awesome. There he was, you know, sleeping on our couch with not a cent in his pocket, just absolutely trusting the universe that he would get there and get back. And he did. And that's how he lives his life, right? And it's the coolest thing ever. And I have learned so much from him. And so then we ended up doing this conference together in Saarbrücken. A year and a half ago, something like that. And I was so overjoyed to see him. I hadn't seen him in so long. And I said, Harold, I don't know what it is, but we've got to do something together. We're supposed to do something together. So we sat down and we did Dangerous Imagination, Silent Assimilation together. And I think that the sum total of what we could do together, me and Harold, is so much greater and better and more amazing than what we could each do singly that I'm just... I'm super, super excited that we were able to do this thing together. And he's the coolest guy in the whole wide world. When Miles went to pick him up to take over from Simon Park, yeah, mm-hmm. He was coming from Switzerland and he was going to be there for one day and then he was going back to Frankfurt. But he had been in the same clothes for like, I don't even know how long. So he made Miles pull over into a department store and buy him new shoes because it's... and he just threw his shoes out the window because he was like, well, I can't wear these anymore. Here's some new shoes. And
that's
off
great.
He goes to the next
that's
interview.
Great.
Yeah, and my husband and I spent the night in Marlborough because we didn't want to go back to London. And in this old pub, I can't remember what the name of it was, but in this stupid band playing until 2 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, we're basically old people, so we wanted to sleep. Find out that Harold has come from, you know, the Barge Inn drinking this green alien beer that they make there.
Oh, and, nice.
And he's sitting in, he sat in with the band till 2 o'clock in the morning.
Cool.
The guy doesn't need any sleep, man. He doesn't need to eat. He doesn't need to sleep. And that is ascension. Okay. This is what happens as you start to evolve. And Johnston will say that is the hallmark of a true abduction, actually, is that people come back with very little need to eat or sleep anymore. Mm-hmm. Because you've evolved.
Yep.
In various ways.
Moved
so anyway, so that's how I met Harold. Harold is phenomenal. Harold will, he has a bunch of psychics working around him and they will periodically call him and tell him to run for the border because they're after him. So that may be what's going on today.
His remote viewers basically summoned him and said, get out of Dodge.
Yeah, you get just, you know, you just need to cross the German border. You'll be okay, Harold. You can come back tomorrow. So he does.
Well, I think this interview served whichever way we do this, because honestly, everything's serendipitous and everything is perfect in its own way. So it was
it
good.
Is.
We got a chance to connect on a level.
It is. I'm so glad finally, right?
Yeah.
And we could do it anytime you want. Okay. But I'll be here. I'll be in the States for another month and then I'm going back to England. But
okay.
I can Skype from there too.
Good. Good.
Oh, excellent. And by the way, today is the launch of the Dangerous Imagination in German. It's finally ready. It's out today. Woo!
All right. All right.
It would have been out months ago, except Harold was doing the translation.
So he wound up doing the translation on that.
He did. Okay. And he's so busy and he's so distractible. Anyway, it's out today.
Big news. Yeah. Big announcement.
Big news. I'm going to go eat with my kids.
Cara, anything else you want to say wrapping this up?
Yeah, there's three things.
Okay.
Turn off your TV. Nothing you can get out of that television. It's not redeemable. It was not invented to do anything but enslave you. Turn it off. Get it out of your house. All right. You got to stay on the computer, though, because that's the only way we're getting the real deal. It's the only way we're getting any real news. And that is the double-edged sword, and that's how we are turning it against them. If you want to know more about education, primarily in the United States, you look up a fellow called John Taylor Gatto. That's G-A-T-T-O. You listen and to everything he has to say, you read everything he's ever written, and you will never feel the same about education again in your life, okay? Number three, you remember who you are. And if I can borrow this from somebody famous, you know, who may or may not be legit, I don't know. Get up off your knees, humanity, okay? You are the most important thing going right now, and they are after Sophia. They are after our beloved holy grail of a cosmic entity planet. They are after it through you because you are the protector. That's how important you are, and that they and you do that. You make everything. You make everything you see via your imagination. So don't ever let anybody tell you that your imagination is nothing, because your imagination is everything. If those are the things I want to say to you, all right? And I hope to talk to Randy again really soon.
You do, you do. Cara St. Louis, thanks for making time for us on Off Planet Radio, Off Planet TV. And that's going to close out this segment. We'll be back with another one soon. Wrap.
Yay! That's well, there you go.
That was pretty freaking awesome.
Thank you. Well, you know...